believe this tonight? Do y'all believe this? It's been a rough couple of days, hasn't it? All right. Before I get started, or if I get started or whatever, I just kind of wanted to share a few thoughts, maybe give y'all a chance to share a few thoughts, ask questions, anything. If just kind of an unusual situation we find ourselves in, and I thought tonight might be a good chance just to ease into things. And I want to share a passage of scripture, just a couple of verses. Psalm 121. It says, I lift up my eyes to the hills, from where does my help come? My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. Where does my help come? My help comes from the Lord. And I'm talking, I'm assuming everybody's heard about Josh and what I'm referring to. I guess I just wanted to offer you a couple words of encouragement. I'm not standing up here and saying I've got all the answers. You may ask me a question. I have absolutely no idea how to answer. Maybe we'll walk through it together. I guess the one thing I want to encourage you to do, and it's something we all need to do, and regardless of whatever difficulty we go through in life, is make sure you process through emotions. You know, when we come across times like this, because I'm sure there's all kinds of different things running through your head. You know, I mean, if you're not sure what I'm talking about, read Facebook. You'll see different things people put on there, and just some things kind of retarded, and some things really heartfelt. You know, because I guess one of the things that stuck out to me as I kind of skimmed through it is I saw a lot of statements of regret. Josh was, he was kind of on the fringe of our group. He was, you know, and somebody even made that statement. And, you know, and so how does that make us feel? Does it give us some regret that maybe we should have done something, said something? But ultimately that comes back to him. He's got to say something or do something and ask. But as you think through that, you know, and we all have regrets in life, and we all regret things, but the thing with regret lives in the past. You can't live in the past. You know, if you got feelings of regret, that's okay. If you're mad at him, that's okay too. If you're mad at God, that's okay. God's big. He's big. But I guess what you need to do, because if you have that feeling of regret, that comes in all different shapes and sizes. Small things. This is pretty big one, maybe. It's not a good feeling, really. And as I thought about that word, there's something I thought about, well, how can I make sure I don't feel this anymore? Just turn that regret into resolve. You know what I mean by resolve? Resolve means you make up your mind. You're going to move forward, you make up your mind that you're going to take action, you make up your mind that you're going to hold your head. Because when you do that, then there's no room for regret in your life, because you're always moving forward. And if God puts something on your heart to talk to somebody, to say something, to do something, to do it because you move forward, because you do it for yourself. And you know, and kind of the bottom line of all this, Josh lived his life. He made his decisions. Now we all have lives to live and decisions to make. The question is, what are we going to do with those? You know, so that's kind of my thoughts on it. Anybody want to share anything, ask anything, any frustration, anything? Floor's open. Didn't want to not give y'all a chance to ask or share or whatever. I guess a good memory. Anything. And if you don't, we'll move right along.
We are here for y'all, okay? If you
Okay. I have, I plan to start a series tonight on the essentials of life. And I think it's going to be a good lead into it, and you know, and a good fit for it. Because one of the probably ridiculous comments I saw on Facebook last night, so it takes death for people to apologize. Not exactly sure what she meant by that, but the boneheaded reply was, and maybe y'all know the guy knows exactly what I'm talking about, and if it wasn't boneheaded, I apologize. But his reply was, well, that's because they don't really mean it. You know. And so, obviously, there's an issue here of forgiveness. And that's the first thing we're going to talk about as we look at these essentials of the Christian life. You know, and one of the reasons, well, let me back up. You remember one thing Charlie used to always try to hammer into you guys about relationships? You remember what his thing was? Guard your heart, right? And he always did that because he tried to stress the point, well, number one, that the heart is deceitfully wicked, right? And number two, just because at your age and at your maturity level, you just aren't prepared for those types of relationships. And you weren't intended to be. And sometimes we as parents even push you guys into it, encourage them in different things. And so Charlie really tried to drive that point home. And I think the story I just shared kind of speaks to that, is it shows that you're just not prepared for that type of relationship. And part of the reason, one of the reasons, is because oftentimes in relationships, give and take, relationships are mistakes and forgiveness. And if your heart's not prepared to forgive, then you're not prepared for that type of relationship. Now, in your defense, the adult population doesn't do a very good job of this either. You know, so this ain't all just you not knowing how to forgive, because we don't do it very well either. And so, you know, tonight I want to kind of start a series. It's going to be in Luke chapter 17. And it's as Jesus is kind of, his ministry is kind of coming to the height, really, of his ministry, and he's kind of moving towards Jerusalem, and we know what happens in Jerusalem, and he's kind of going in that direction. He really starts to focus on training his disciples and giving them key information for what they need to have. You know, recognizing that he is not always going to be there, recognizing that at some point they're going to have to take the ball and run with it. And so he's kind of starting to train them to take over the mantle, if you will. So Luke chapter 17, and there's really, as we're going to look at this over the next 3 or 4 weeks. Oh, and actually, can y'all fix that echo, or is that just my ears?
We could do about it. It's just the gym.
No, it's not usually here. Okay, anyway, we'll work through it. Before I forget, next week Shad is going to be here. He's not coming to stay next week, but he's kind of coming to spend the week, kind of make some plans. He'll be here next Wednesday night to kind of watch things, see how things go, maybe even on the following Sunday. So I did want to throw that out there that he will be with us next week. If you want to get the word out about that. But for the next 3 or 4 weeks, we're going to be right here in Luke chapter 17, kind of going through these things as Jesus ramps up his teaching of his disciples. So this week we're going to talk about forgiveness. Next week it'll be on faithfulness. And then we'll look at being thankful and then being prepared, you know, for that day. So let me set the stage for you. Luke 17, and I mentioned this is kind of as Jesus is starting to move, you know, towards Jerusalem. He had left Jerusalem. Y'all remember several months ago now, I guess, we talked about the I Am series, and one of the things that was going on, they tried to stone Jesus, and so he left Jerusalem. And this kind of picks up right where that left off. And he had crossed the Jordan River and was traveling around the countryside. And the Bible just says, and it's in Luke chapter 13, the Bible says he went on his way through the towns and villages teaching and journeying toward Jerusalem. An interesting phrase, journeying toward Jerusalem. So that means he's making his way back to Jerusalem and the events that will happen there. And so on his journey, he begins to teach his disciples. And in chapter 14, and you know, sometimes the story of Jesus kind of jumps around through the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke especially, and it's not necessarily in chronological order, so you can't always just read straight through. But over the next few weeks, what we'll see in chapter 17 is pretty much the order in which things begin to happen. But the context of what we're talking about tonight, it actually goes all the way back into chapters 13 and 14, and it says things like, now great crowds accompany him. You know, he's developing his following, he's coming after him as he's doing his teaching, and so they begin to accompany him. And then in Luke 15, it says, now the tax collectors and sinners were drawing near to him. You know, and so not just disciples and people who followed him, but even people who weren't sure what was going on, they're like, hey, what is this guy saying? You know, what's all this fuss about? And so he's beginning to attract attention of lost people. You know, that's kind of how the Bible says it sometimes. Lost people were tax collectors and sinners, and so he's drawing these people to him. And then it'll make a statement like, and he also said to his disciples. So that means, you know, at one time he's focusing on the crowd, and then the next time he might turn his focus specifically to his disciples and address them. And then at some time, as the Pharisees kind of come in and out of the picture, he will specifically address them and kind of call them out on things. And so we find ourselves now in chapter 17. This is one of those moments where, you know, he may have just shared a parable with the crowd, and then he turns to his disciples. You know, and so now this is some intense teaching for them to kind of help turn them over to what's going on. And so that's where we pick this up in these four key lessons over the next few weeks. And so just in the first couple of verses, and he said to his disciples, temptations to sin are sure to come, but woe to the one through whom they come. So what does that mean? You know, we're gonna stumble. We're going to make mistakes. We're going to sin. We're going to fall. And so he said, that's going to happen. We're sinners. We live in a sinful world. But the point he's making here is, he's reminding us very clearly, you don't be the one to make somebody else stumble. I mean, you've heard the reference to that, right? Don't be a stumbling block for your brothers. And girls, I think y'all especially get called out sometimes, you know, on the way you dress. Don't be a stumbling block for your brothers. But girls, you know, that works both ways. If guys do stupid things and make you do stupid things, and, you know, so it works both ways. So we're not going to pick on you about that. But, you know, that's usually the thing we think of when we're talking about. Don't be a stumbling block. Don't cause your brother or your sister to sin. You know, don't do something stupid to make them sin. You know, look out for each other. And that's what we're going with this. And this is one of my favorite verses, and it's really actually recorded in more than one place. It would be better for him if a millstone were hung around his neck and if he were cast in the sea than you should cause somebody to stumble. So think about that. He's saying it's better if we hang a rock around your neck and pitch you in the ocean and you die a slow death of drowning